whose coming we await, you invite us into light and presence. Illumine the dim places of our hearts. We are thirsty for your compassion. Draw near to us and fill us, that we may pour your goodness out to all who hunger. Amen. Purify our conscience, Almighty God, by your daily visitation, that your Son, Jesus Christ, at his coming, may find in us a mansion prepared for himself, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Again the Lord spoke to Ahaz, saying, "Ask a sign of the Lord your God. Let it be deep as Sheol or high as heaven." But Ahaz said, "I will not ask, and I will not put the Lord to the test." Then Isaiah said, "Hear then, O house of David, is it too little for you to weary mortals, that you weary my God also? Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the young woman is with child, and shall bear a son, and shall name him Emmanuel. He shall eat curds and honey by the time he knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good. For before the child knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good, the land before whose two kings you are in dread will be deserted." Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thank you.
beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, the gospel concerning his son, who was descended from David according to the flesh, and was declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by resurrection from the dead. Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith among all the Gentiles for the sake of his name, including yourselves, who are called to belong to Jesus Christ, to all God's beloved in Rome, who are called to be saints. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. You can't see it from there, but I'm wearing socks. And my socks, for some of the kids around, do you know what kind of socks I've been wearing this season? I see Charlie and Georgia knows. What kind of socks am I wearing? Can you tell me? Can you tell us? Advent socks! I have Advent socks! and socks for every week. So you can come and look. This one is 4 weeks. And the first week is really burnt low. It's kind of fun. So I'm wearing my Advent socks, and the children at Children's Chapel or with the pageant, they know that I've been wearing a different pair of socks every week. But what they don't know is that I'm wearing one different sock, or two different socks. The other one looks like this, and I know no one can see this, but if you're close, what other sock would I happen to be wearing, Abigail Akers? What do you think?
Hanukkah sock.
A Hanukkah sock! I didn't even ask her before to prep. So Hanukkah, yes, right? Because it begins this evening. 8 nights of pure joy and surprise and, dare I say, miracle that when the temple was going to be rededicated, they thought they only had oil for enough light to light. Wow, that was awful. I'm so sorry, everybody. It's been a while since I've been up here. I'm really glad to be here, partly because you all have given me the task of reflecting on this particular passage this Sunday on Joseph. I have to say, I haven't spent much time with Joseph. You know, I like a lot of my saints, as many of you know. Mary is a particular character in the Advent season that really opens us all up for Christmas. But Joseph, I never really related to him because he seems so stoic. You know, Joseph was a righteous man, and he thought this thing, and he was going to divorce her, and then he had a dream, and he changed his mind. And then he was perfect the entire time. You do not hear from Joseph. You see a picture of him maybe when you're a kid, teaching his son how to be a carpenter, but that's about it. We don't hear from Joseph, this staunch figure in our own Christian imagination that we're supposed to follow. How do I even relate to this man that I know nothing about? I kind of know something about. I know his family and where he comes from, and I know that he stayed pretty faithful to Mary, even amidst all of that turmoil with society and what they might have thought about her and Jesus. Is that supposed to be enough for me? And I wonder if that's supposed to be enough for you. So I thought about it, and again, I'm really grateful because most of the time when I reflect on these passages, I do three things. I look for myself. Where would I be in this story? And then I look for other people. Where are the other people? What do they look like? How do they interact? And then where can I find God in this story? So I kind of have to go through myself a little bit. Most of the time my sermons or my reflections are a bit personal because God works through all of us in our personhood and what we know and what we've come to love and what we've come to care about. And so I invite you, too, to jump on in. Go ahead and close your eyes, if it's helpful. Where would you be in the story? If it's helpful and you're like, what story did we read? Go ahead and look in your bulletin. I don't care. Take the bulletin home, reflect on it this week, as I always encourage you to do. That's why we print it. Where would you be in this story? Would you be the Joseph that says, oh, well, if you're married, I don't want to disgrace you. I should probably do what's acceptable so that no harm comes upon you. So I will just back away. We won't get married. We won't continue this so that you won't be disgraced. I'll keep my mouth shut. We'll be good. Or perhaps like one of the kids getting ready for the Christmas pageant as an angel. Maybe I'm the angel that interrupts this story and says, hey, wake up. Wake up. Do not be afraid. Have you ever found yourself telling your friends or your family, hey, wake up. Just don't be afraid. Because maybe perhaps you too are like this angel that takes this moment and says, do not be afraid. you have to continue that sentence, right? Because God is with you. Because we can be afraid all the time, but when we know that God is with us, kind of tempers our fear. Or perhaps, are you with society, the people? No real character, just social customs and mores and the acceptable things. Where are you in this story? So I thought about it for myself. I'm not a big dreamer like Joseph, you know? So I'm like, oh, another strike against Joseph, you know? Righteous, faithful, and he had dreams. He had three dreams. One dream was this one that redirected his course of action. And the two others actually continued to direct his action. One was, don't go back there. Go to Egypt. Take your family and take them to Egypt. I don't know if he knew anyone there, but just go. So he took his family and went. And then his third dream was, okay, it's safe now to return. Come back. Man, his righteousness, his search for the truth, justice, what is right, what is correct, what is acceptable, and his faithfulness, those three dreams, powerful. But I can't relate to that. I don't really dream. For those of you who know me, I don't really sleep. So I don't really give God time, right, to work in that way, in that space, in that pause, in that moment where my body can relax. I can be close to dead space, maybe even, or allow my brain to turn off its on button, like in our nervous system, right? It's either on or off. I don't allow more time to be off, to allow God to do something there. So I'm like, how do I relate to Joseph? I'm supposed to give this sermon. And then I read something about being the adoptive parent to Jesus. I'm like, oh yeah, how does that work, right? As in our human minds, we try to make it all logical that Jesus had a mom, had God, gave birth through the Holy Spirit, and then had a human father, of course. So he's the adoptive father. For those of you who know, I have three children. Some of you may not know that I am not the birthing parent of these three children. These three children have the same DNA from the same mom, who is my spouse, and the same DNA from another person that we don't know, called a donor. Now, we've been telling our children that's how they were born. So I guess you can say I'm the adoptive parent. And for some reason, I'm like, I am, but we also decided to conceive together. So I don't want to say there's a difference. It's so complex when we talk about conception these days, not just because of technology, but because of our households and our families and how we've all been made up. Some of us are blood related and some of us are not, and we're still family. And so I think of being the adoptive father, and I'm like, oh, Joseph, I can relate. Because I wonder if he wonders inside. Was that too much of me being stern when they're not really my kids? But they really are my kids, so I can be that sterner, I can be that loving, or I can be that whatever it is. And so in the last couple weeks, some of you might have noticed in your feed or not that the U.S. government passed with the Respect for Marriage Act. And I thought about how that impacts my family in particular. And years ago when my wife and I decided to get married, it was protected here. We can get married in California, but we couldn't get married in 35 other states. And so years ago when I was looking for a job, my friend from Tennessee said, hey, why don't you look at this? It'd be awesome to have you have us work together. So the first thing we did, not even look at the job description, we looked at the state of Tennessee. And I would have had to adopt my children in the state of Tennessee because gay marriage is not honored there or respected there. Again, one of 35 other states in the union who don't do it. So for my family, fleeing and staying and all of that, I'm like, oh, Joseph is really coming along. God, at least this low barrier of civil rights for many of us has been established, because there's great fear that our rights as a married family, which then say that we now have children that we're responsible for, that can be taken away. And so this Respect for Marriage Act is now in place as a safeguard for that. I can go to another state and they would federally have to acknowledge our marriage, which then assumes that I am my children's parents, which is a really big, if you don't know me, a really big identity for me, right, as a parent. So I would say surprise yourself and jump into the story and see what God has in store. When you think of, oh, I don't know if I can relate to a person like Joseph, or I don't know if I can relate to a virgin like Mary, or I don't know if I can relate, you know, think about it big time. God wants to find you there. So that's the first thing I do. I look at myself, and I know that it's not just me, you know, that I'm kind of sharing this reflection with. So then I want us to look at others. I want us to look into the story for others. I think of Mary and Joseph, and I'm like, wow, in all of God's plan to have Jesus born, these are the two people you're going to choose to have everyday, daily life for his entire life. Can you imagine if you were on the committee, the God committee, and had to decide who's going to be the parent of said Jesus? God incarnate in the world. Like, what characteristics would you look for? Last year, we did this whole search for a rector. We came up with all these things, right? About who the perfect person or person that works for this community would be for us. God did that in God's, you know, three self, in God's Trinity, and planned that Mary and Joseph would be the parents to God. So that's why it's a little problematic for me, because so many times we keep them very distant. I don't know if I can relate to Mary. I don't know if I can relate to Joseph. They're kind of perfect. But they're not, because their society was not perfect. How do you remain faithful to what God is calling you to do when you've got everyone around you saying the opposite? That is not okay to live that way. That is against the law. Well, when the law doesn't work for you, you got to change that. So I think of Mary and Joseph, and I see them, and I wonder, as I'm looking at these presents, right? Thank you, everyone who contributed to the Giving Tree. Because of you, six families out of Samaritan House's sharing program.
Seven total?
Seven, and I'm sure a few others. If some of you are doing it on your own, sneaky little people you all are, right? So at least seven families are getting the comfort of food, the comfort of care, and not gonna lie, some entertainment, some toys, some gifts, the gift of giving because of you all. If we were to imagine those seven families and see them as a reflection of Mary, Joseph, Jesus, God is with us. Joseph was supposed to name his son Jesus, right? I think in Hebrew it's something like Joshua, maybe it's something like saves. He who saves. That this little baby is going to save us all. Maybe save us all from ourselves. Maybe save us all from those moments where we create barriers with one another that are not liberating, that are not freeing, that put people as a them and keeps us as an us. But I wonder, when I look at the others, this holy family, when we go deliver these presents today, be prepared to meet another holy family, everybody. Be prepared for that as you leave this church, to meet holy people, holy families, that God is working something amazing, redirecting their lives, and they are following something to create a miracle amidst us. Are you paying attention? And so lastly, I going to leave it to you, because I did a lot of work this week preparing for you all. So I'm going to leave it to you. I'm not going to ask for answers now, but I really do want you to think about it. Right? The third part is now look and try to find God in this story. Where is God in this story? If we are all made in the image and likeness of God, then the opposite is true as well. That God is this miraculous, amazing, spectacular, unifying image of all of us being as faithful and righteous and just as possible. So I just wonder, St. Paul's, as people, individual people, consider being a little more like Joseph. He was kind of like following the rules and understanding the rules for a particular moment and then open to being redirected. That when those rules didn't work for certain people, he followed God and that was the most aligning path he took. And then what if St. Paul's, as a community, what about if we all look up to each other, and we all look up to our neighbors, and we all look up like Jesus, redirected much of what we've been living as or for, continuing to align with God? What is that invitation for us this coming season? Let's say amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the Holy Church of God, that it may be filled with truth and love, and be found without fault at the day of your coming, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, for Mark, our bishop, for the upcoming bishop search in the Diocese of California, for all bishops and other ministers, and for all the holy people of God, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease, and that all may be one as you and the Father are one, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those in positions of public trust, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who live and work in this community, especially the children, teens, and mentors who have been preparing to tell again the timeless story of Jesus' birth at St. Paul's Christmas Eve pageant next Saturday. As we marvel at the miracle of love incarnate coming among us as a vulnerable baby, may our hearts be transformed. And may Christ find us eager to welcome your grace and goodness that seek to be born in us every day of the year. We pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For a blessing upon all human labor, and for the right use of riches of creation, that the world may be freed from poverty, famine, and disaster, we pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For ourselves, for the forgiveness of our sins, for the grace of the Holy Spirit to amend our lives, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have commended themselves to our prayers, especially John Anderson, Brock, Sharon B., Leslie Bonina, Diana Fave, Forrest Family, Ann George, Dean Harmon, Ruth Haynes, Hinkson Family, Jones Family, Margaret Kane, Larry Margolis, John Miller, Jessica Mueller, Heather Nyland, Karen Payne, James Prescott, George Simon, Pamela Stevens, Riley Volpi, people of Ukraine, people of Russia, people of Afghanistan, St. Andrew's High School in Tonka. For our families, friends, and neighbors, that being freed from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the communion of your church, Bruce Bearden, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that, with all the saints, they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Let us say our prayer for mission together.
Gracious and loving God, help us this day to understand and celebrate the beauty of the world, to be transformed in Jesus' love, and to use our gifts to make a difference for others. Amen.
For yours is the majesty, and Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, now and forever. Amen. Let us confess our sins unto Almighty God. God of all mercy, we confess that we have sinned against you, opposing your will in our lives. We have denied your goodness in each other. our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Dear friends, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
Good morning, I'm Susan Matthews, the director of music, and this afternoon we're really looking forward to offering the 7th annual Christmas concert. This will be by the Choir of St. Paul's and will include children in the choir school from kindergarten through the adults in our choir. Thank you for all of you who have already purchased your tickets. To make sure you can get in easily, please bring the ticket on your phone or print it out and then you can come right in. We'll still have tickets available at the door, and the doors will open at 3:30, and Lena Chea will be selling those tickets. And we look forward to seeing them.
Thank you, Dr. Matthews. Edith, do you want to come up and make an announcement about Martin Luther King? Again, thank you.
This is my outdoor voice. No, I'm going to make this fast. So I want to let you know that there is a Martin Luther King Day of Service on January 16th, and is organized by the Peninsula Multi-Faith Coalition. And I hope that you will take a look at the projects that are offered that day and see if there's some way you want to help, whether it's donate to the book drive, clean up at the elementary school, decorate pillows for life groups. Information is in your bulletin. I'd be happy to answer any questions you have. I think there are over a dozen different projects. Some have age restrictions on them, but the information can be found online, and I'm glad to help you. So please consider volunteering. Sign-ups, by the way, are underway already and going until January 8th.
Till January 8th, you have to sign up. And we are looking to gather a team of folks from St. Paul's who might like to help some of our younger members who want to be part of this. Young people are engaged with service in our community in lots of different ways, and they would love to have a chance to learn alongside you and to help mentor us as we look outward to what God is up to in our city. There are even outdoor projects. There are opportunities to sing for seniors. I know some of our parishioners were looking for ways to do that during the holidays, so there are lots of ways to be extending this love in an active form to our city and to the surrounding area of the wider peninsula. Speaking of love in action, as Jocelyn mentioned in her sermon, we have quite an opportunity to build relationships with families who are these holy families among us. And I would like to ask anyone who's had a hand in giving, or if you were wrapping, or if you were delivering, anyone who's had a hand in giving this year, just to stand up where you are. We're going to pray a prayer of blessing, not only over these expressions of care and compassion, but also over you all, because you are the hands and feet of Christ, reaching out in love for this world that God is so connected with, and that God deeply loves. So let us pray. God of abundance, God of compassion, your faithfulness stirs us to participate in your love, flowing ever outward in generosity and joy. We ask that you bless both these members of our community who have given in love and those who will receive these expressions of care and comfort. Bless our community as we grow deeper in friendships that are mutually transformative and life-giving. And may all those whose holidays are enlivened by this food and these presents experience your life together. Lighten the load of those who struggle in our communities, and your care and kindness break into our lives changing us in unimaginable ways. All this we ask through the greatest gift of all, your Son, Jesus Christ, who came to be among us and to show us what it is to be truly human, truly divine. Amen. You may be seated. We're doing announcements a little bit in reverse order this morning, but I am Sarah Stewart, and it's my privilege to welcome you. Thank you, Jocelyn, for such a magnificent sermon. And thank you all for being here on this fourth Sunday of Advent. We have one more week to prepare the way in our hearts and in our lives for everything that God wants to reveal by God's breaking in among us in the incarnation of love. Whether you are here for the first time, you're back after a long time, you're coming back after being away, we know that your presence is a gift and grace. All are welcome at Christ's table. We have gluten-free bread if that is something that you need. And if you'd rather have a blessing, just cross your arms over your chest and we will pray that prayer over you as we come by with the bread. However you are drawn deeper into love in this sacred season, we see God's light and love in you, and we celebrate that gift, which is grace for the world. So let us walk in that love of our Lord Jesus Christ, the one who led him to come and be among us as love itself, offering itself for the sake of the world.
Thank you.
and to give you thanks, for you alone are God, living and true, dwelling in light inaccessible from before time and forever. Fountain of life and source of all goodness, you made all things and fill them with your blessing. You created them to rejoice in the splendor of your radiance. Countless throngs of angels stand before you to serve you night and day, and beholding the glory of your presence, they offer you unceasing praise. Joining with them and giving voice to every creature under heaven, we acclaim you and glorify your name as we sing. Sanctifying them and showing them to be holy gifts for your holy people. bread of life and the cup of salvation, the body and blood of our Savior Jesus Christ. Grant that all who share this bread and cup may become one body and one spirit, a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your name. Remember, Lord, your one holy, Catholic, and Apostolic Church, redeemed by the blood of your Christ. Reveal its unity, guard its faith, and preserve it in peace. And grant that we may find our inheritance with the Blessed Virgin Mary, with matriarchs, patriarchs, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all the saints who have found favor with you in ages past. We praise you in union with them and give you glory through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty God, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power. one of our sisters.